doing?
My father was born as George Alexander Huels, and he was born in April 2nd, 1947. In 2015, he passed away due to complications with cancer and other illnesses and such. It was hard to deal with, and that happened around 4 years ago, and I still hadn't gotten over it, you know. A little bit ago, when I decided to shoot this, I wanted to go visit my dad at his grave, because I hadn't visited his gravesite in a while, and I just wanted to say hi and check up on it, make sure it's alright. It was a good start, you know, just saying hi and updating my dad a little bit on what's going on in my life. A little bit after that, my friends decided that we wanted to go eat and get Wingstop.
I don't know.
After visiting my dad, I had a definite dip in mood. I felt a lot less emotive. I definitely felt a lot less. I felt a lot more withdrawn. I didn't really feel very well. And that pretty much carried on all the way into to eating at Wingstop, pretty much. The entire time I was there, you know, I was having fun with my friends. But at the same time, I still felt really down and really low. But we decided to watch a movie, Charlie's Angels, the new one, which is total shit. But after that, we wanted to go to IKEA. And something pretty interesting happened over there.
It's dinner, sir. My pussy is dinner.
How are you feeling?
While we were, you know, messing around in IKEA on the sets and stuff, I remember that I used to do that really often around 2 or 3 years ago with my best friend Gio. Occasionally go to IKEA and just film stuff, whether it's for a project or stuff like that. And I noticed a bit later that some of the old sets that we'd film on were still there. It was pretty surreal seeing that. Some of those sets haven't changed in IKEA. And it kinda made me think back to all those dumb videos that we filmed at IKEA. It was pretty cool.
You! What are you doing in my bathroom?
I'm powerful, man.
I need to get my porn stash!
I'm a mob boss, I'm back home.
I wish I had a wife who made me food.
I gotta get my magazine!
pizza me! Come, I am waiter, I help you out, a good boy!
You!
Whoa!
After having a little bit more to eat, for dinner, we decided to stick around a bit more, just walk around for a little bit, but we decided to head home after that. And after I got home, I started to record.
I'm really stressed out. I don't really know what to do. I'm just kind of pacing around the house, but I don't know, I'm just like, I'm really stressed out, you know, I got exams and everything, and it's like the second last semester, and you know, I've got like a show coming up, like a music thing on Saturday, and I haven't really rehearsed the music because I don't really care about the songs we're playing, maybe for, except a couple, but I'm just really stressed out.
After that, I kind of decided to just have a walk about my neighborhood to go buy cigarettes and just kind of contemplate, you know, everything that's going on. I do this walk a lot, walking to go to KK Mart or 7-Eleven, just to think about what's going on in my life and just reflect on everything. I bought the cigarettes and an iced tea, and I headed back to park and had a little sit down with myself. But while I was sitting down at my usual spot, I noticed something a bit different.
So, a little bit ago, I had a bit of a, not a breakup, but somewhat, whatever the word is. And there was a important relic or something that I had that I put in this fire pit, and it's completely emptied out. And, you know, there was always part of me every time I'd come to sit here and wonder, you know, if I could get that little thing back, but I guess I can't anymore, so.
After realizing that that little totem or memento that I had was gone, I sat at the fire pit for a little bit longer just to reflect on everything that's going on and think about everything that's in my life. But I decided to pack it in and go to bed pretty early because the next day I had to go visit my old school, which actually turned out to be a pretty lethargic experience.
I'm about to go to GIS to talk to my old teacher, so yeah.
As my grab turned into GIS, and I was waiting at the guardhouse, signing the registration thing or whatever, just so I could get in, it was weird walking through the halls I used to walk through every day, pretty much, as an outsider instead of somebody that would attend school. I saw the kids running around, and I saw new stuff that I wasn't really familiar with.
The fuck is that?
That's new. And I stopped by the secondary office to say hi to the receptionist that I usually greet pretty much every morning. After that, I just waited for my old teacher, Miss Mangan, to come pick me up so I could actually walk around the school without supervision. And we sat down to have a talk about stuff from GIS and stuff from the past.
Yes, so you contacted me out of the blue. When was the last time I saw you?
I think...
must be just over a year ago, yeah, maybe even longer?
Around.
After some long overdue catching up, we started to talk about my dad.
Yeah. And then, well, your dad passed when you were in year 11, wasn't it?
I think, yeah, 2015. Yeah.
Year 11?
Yeah.
16, 17. Yeah. And my memories are your dad walking you into school all the time, you know, and you just had this great relationship with your dad. Yeah. I felt like butter wouldn't melt in your mouth in front of your dad. Do you know what I mean? Dad, you could do anything and your dad just loved you. I think your dad sort of made excuses for you a little bit.
He definitely did.
He was a bit soft on you, I just remember your dad being very tall and
I've got that.
And you were really short.
Yeah.
How long was your dad sick for?
My dad was sick since...
when was he diagnosed?
2014, I think.
Oh, so literally it was sudden.
Yeah, it was very sudden.
And it was...
It was prostate cancer. He had prostate cancer? Yeah.
Are you for real?
Yeah.
And he never got checked? Or?
No, he got checked because it was a scary moment, I remember.
After that, we started to talk about the period in time where I was pretty much smoking weed every day.
Like,
I think you were quite lost in year 12 because you're thinking, okay, what do I do? Where do I go? Perhaps subconsciously thinking, well, mum's moved on.
And on the back of that conversation, we decided to talk about the period in time where I was pretty much drinking every day for around 2 weeks.
It was over Chinese New Year.
But wasn't that because you were nicking the alcohol from your mum?
Yeah.
You told me you were drinking.
Yeah.
Remember? Do you remember?
Yeah.
You told me. But how long did it last for?
I started...
Your mum came in, yeah. Because Miss Robinson, remember, was talking to your mum. I don't think I had any meetings with your mum. It was with Miss Robinson.
I went through...
Were you drinking and then sleeping, then get wake again, then drink again and sleep?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. But you weren't doing anything stupid, were you?
No, I wasn't like going around being like, fuck off.
No, you're just in the room drinking.
Yeah, I was just in my bedroom drinking.
Drinking for the sake of drinking?
Drinking for the sake of feeling something else.
You were fairly withdrawn.
Yeah.
Actually, there was one, I don't know whether it was that time of year, but there was one time where you seemed to just sort of be sitting here on your own.
Then after that, we started talking about how I tend to only look back on the good memories, and Miss Mangan said a really poignant thing about looking back on the past.
But that's the point, though. You know, you have these memories, but they don't dictate who we are now.
Yeah.
You know, we've all done things, we've said things that we're not impressed with, or we're not happy with ourselves over. You know, I have as well. You know, I'm not perfect, and no one is. You know, but I can acknowledge that, and I either learn from it or I just move on from it. Hang on to your good memories, like your dad.
Yeah.
You know, and like I said, I still picture you and your dad walking down those bloody stairs, walking past the office there, walking along here. Your dad literally taking you to your bloody form class, you know?
I actually forgot about that, yeah.
After wrapping up that conversation, I mentioned the new common room that the sixth form have, and Miss Mangan decided to take me down there and show me around.
Because it's all like fancy, and it's all
about,
like, yeah, because that'd be cool, yeah.
Walking past old classrooms and an old photo that they hung up of my friend Sam, and into the common room, it was a real blast from the past, but at the same time, it wasn't. You know, the sixth form common room had a kitchen now. From when I remembered it, all it was just a big old room with a bunch of purple couches in it. But it was weird seeing this place different, and different from how I knew it. But as I was leaving, Miss Mangan told me a story about how her grandma makes spaghetti bolognese differently from when she did when Miss Mangan was younger. And she talked to me about change. And for the life of me, I can't remember exactly what she said, but it was something along the lines of change is inevitable, and that it's something you have to accept and embrace. Otherwise, getting caught in the past is more lethal than it actually could be. The next few days of that week, I felt pretty fucking awful. And I was drinking a bit. But I had a gig on Saturday. I've had a pretty both boring and rough year so far. And I thought maybe playing a gig again for the first time in 2 years would maybe alleviate some of that pressure. And it kind of did. But the nervousness that I felt leading up to it was immeasurable. First up, when I first got there, I was already nervous. Then I saw the people that were going to be there. Even though not all of them were going to watch, I still felt pretty nervous. And the anticipation, because our set got delayed and stuff, and the waiting and to see if all the time and effort we put into rehearsing was going to be worth it. But I honestly didn't want to play when I first saw the band that played directly before us. Then we got up on stage and we started playing, and it kind of ended up a bit different. If you couldn't tell, that's me playing the drums. And much to my surprise, we ended up being the crowd favorite. We ended up having the biggest crowd out of all the bands that played there. And that's not a subtle flex, that is a very definite big flex, because I felt really confident. And even though I was really shy and meek at the beginning, I was playing my ass off and I was really happy to be there. And it was a lot of fun. Also, I think I deserve to show that shot of everybody raging out to Mr. Brightside and listening to me shred ass on that drum kit. Honestly, when I first started this project about a year ago, I didn't think much of it. I thought it was really fun to do, and I thought the end product was really cool, but I never really intended this to go anywhere else. And the whole reason I'm doing this is I was watching it again, and I was thinking about everything that's happened to me in the past year, in the past 5 years, and it kind of made me want to look back and kind of expose a part of me that I don't really talk about and I don't really show anybody. The whole time when I was making it, I felt like shit. And bringing up old memories kind of hurt a little too much than it should have, but still felt good to let that part of me out and let people know about it and just express myself. So thanks for watching, and always remember, that's life.
That's life.
That's life.
That's what all the people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that tune. When I'm back on top in June. I said that's life.
That's life.
As funny as it may seem, some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. 'Cause this fine old world, it keeps spinning around. I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself flat on my face, I pick myself up and get back in the race. That's life.
That's life.
But if there's nothing shaking come this here July, I'm gonna roll myself up in a big ball and die.
I see you in Kufstein, Grandma. Then you can play with me and my teddy bear. Okay? Bye-bye. Dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee.